Hello everyone, Reid here. Welcome to a modern gameplay video here on ChannelFireball.com. The deck that I have in front of me today, you've guessed it, it is Jund Saga. But I'm experimenting with a handful, well, I guess a different structure to the deck than usual. You know, typically when I play Jund, I go up the mana curve to four drops like Shuldred, the One Ring, you know, in the old days, Bloodbraid Elf, whatever it might be. But this time I'm choosing a much lower curve version of Jund Saga. And the payoffs are, first of all, a Giganta Companion, which does come in handy, especially when you play, you know, strange looking games where players are locked under a Blood Moon or whatever. The low curve works really well with both Questing Druid and Mishra's research desk. That's a tongue twister. So the idea is just to be like a little bit leaner, lower to the ground, have lots of cheap cards. And then, you know, once you've played out your hand, you get to turn to your Urza Sagas and your Renin Sixes, for late game staying power. So I'm going to play this through a 4-round preliminary event, and, looks like the event is ready to start. So I hope you'll join me for the gameplay. Okay, very, very nice opening hand. I'm happy with this. So I'll plan to go Blood Crypt into Inquisition and then follow up with Bloodstained Mire, finding some green mana. And Yawgmoth. So this is one of the best decks in Modern right now, probably the biggest winner from the most recent round of bannings, and a tough matchup. This is actually why I have the main deck Pithing Needle, because you can name Yawgmoth himself, you can name Grist, or you can name Agatha's Soul Cauldron, and those are all really, really good and important uses of Pithing Needle. So I guess I'll take one of the Young Wolves, because I kind of want my opponent to just play the Hierarch, and then I can Bowmaster it. But yeah, I mean, they'll probably know the score when I don't take the Hierarch, that I have either Bowmasters or Renin Six, but also, you know, what else are they going to do with the Hierarch besides just play it? Sure, I'm fine with just Forest Bowmasters. So they do have the Boseiju for my Pithing Needle, which is interesting. I think I'm going to attack with the Orc Army and then maybe just pull for Giganta this turn. Like, there's no reason to put the Pithing Needle onto the battlefield way in advance of Yawgmoth. You know, the best use of it is to play this the turn before they play Yawgmoth. Plus, they might just go land Grist, or they might play out the Boseiju, and those are both good outcomes for saving the needle in hand. All right, so choosing my land. Definitely want to get a second source of red, but do I want Blood Crypt, Stomping Ground, or Mountain? I guess Mountain is fine. All right, so there's Boseiju. Increased chance of Pithing Needle sticking around. wondering if I'm playing out the Haywire Might. I think the answer is no. Yawgmoth, Thran Physician. Cast the Ragavan. And hold my breath, hope nothing bad happens. Yep. All right, I guess I'll just pass. If you're not familiar with Questing Druid, the best pattern for this is to use Seek the Beast on the opponent's turn, because then you get to untap and have a full turn cycle to, well, not turn cycle, you get to have a full turn with all your mana to cast the spells. Sometimes you'll see me main phase Seek the Beast, but that's only when I have a lot of mana and am willing to commit myself to casting everything in one turn. All right, so I found a Lightning Bolt, an Inquisition. I guess I'll just bolt that Young Wolf. I'm lucky they don't seem to have drawn much that's useful. They might have redundant copies of Yawgmoth, but they don't seem to have Court of Calling or a way to remove the needle. Right, so it looks like I want to play the Questing Druid, play the Inquisition. So let's do that. Like, the Inquisition's probably just missing here, but we'll see. Yep. So Shuldred, which they're trying to be a little bit cagey with, that makes sense. Okay. No delirium. So I guess I just have to double burn the Shuldred. I mean, maybe I can wait. Can't get the Haywire Might into the graveyard particularly easily. If I double burn the Shuldred, the Questing Druid would be a 4/4. Still can't really attack into the double block here. I think I'll just take my draw and see what happens. All right, I play Gigantha, and if nothing bad happens this turn, then I get to double burn the Shuldred and actually start attacking. Also, like, I wonder if I should just be attacking with the Bowmaster or the Ragavan or something. I don't know. Maybe I've made some bad choices to not achieve Delirium by this point. Deciding what happens if I attack with the Questing Druid. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's still just Gigantha. Could trade their like Ragavan attacks into the Yawgmoth. Then I get a creature in the graveyard for Delirium, bolt the Yawgmoth, Unholy Heat the Shouldred. They do have a redundant Yawgmoth, so that's not that exciting. All right, I'll just play it slow for now. When the Urza Saga comes online, you know, chapter 3, that will guarantee me Delirium because I can get probably Mishra's research desk will be the best. All right, you're casting Grist. You have a Grist. What are you going to do with it? Just one Yawgmoth in hand. Keep in mind my opponent can proliferate the Young Wolf, the Grist. So yes, still this remains pretty tricky. Okay, a second Lightning Bolt is helpful. How about player, Grist, and we'll see what my opponent chooses to do here. This is actually a really good outcome for me because I get to kill off two things for free. Bolt, kill off the Yawgmoth. Unholy Heat. I do still have to choose whether I'm heating the Shouldred or the Grist, and it might have to be the Grist. Yeah, actually, I guess I just say okay here and then heat the Grist and continue playing a little bit of a waiting game. Do I bolt the Yawgmoth? Maybe I... Man, it's tough. Gotta kill that Grist, because that's just gonna dominate the game. Man, Pithing Needle saved me big time this game. Now I think I'm double bolting. I guess I can take two more. The spell bomb can technically protect me from the combo if they wind up killing the Pithing Needle. Or I could just get the research desk, which is probably going to be better. All right, they have found Orcish Bowmasters. So what does that mean? They're going to ping my Haywire Mite, which I'm okay with. I guess I could sack it in response, target my own research desk, sack the research desk until the end of my next turn. Okay, so let's do this, because this is going to fizzle the amass. Taking all the damage. 9, 12, so double bolt. All right, well, that was a game that, like, everything went right for me. My opponent's draw was super one-dimensional, and I was able to shut it down with Pithy Needle. But it still felt pretty tough, and it took me 12 minutes off my clock to win game one. So after sideboarding, I get Terminate and Molten Collapse, which more ways to just outright kill Yawgmoth is a good thing. I think I can trim a Boseiju. I have two in my main deck with the goal that I'm going to often sideboard one out. Graveyard Hate is like not nothing, but it's not super exciting. Cursed Totem is targeted for this matchup, as is Stone of Eric. Shadow Spear is not the worst, because sometimes they have a bunch of just annoying 1/1s and allows you to attack through them. Haywire Might for the Agatha's Soul Cauldron. So I'd say these four cards are really strong. These are the maybes. I'm guessing having one Haywire Might is going to be correct, just so I can search up an answer to the Soul Cauldron when needed. I like keeping all the discard, because taking away Grist is really, really important. Ragavan's awful, especially on the draw. Tarmogoyf's pretty mopey as well. But I don't want to have the Shadow Spear unless I already have a bunch of Goyfs. Want to have definitely at least one more card that I can search up with the Urza Sagas, and I'll make that Nile Spellbomb. The research desk seems fine. I guess all the graveyard hate's fine. A lucky one of Tarmogoyf. Could also be Engineered Explosives if I wanted, but do I have enough ways to actually win the game here? Yeah, I'll win with Urza's Saga after I shut everything down. Okay, let's try it. Another excellent opening hand. Just really, really pumped to have Thoughtseize into Bowmasters both games, or discard spell into Bowmasters. Ooh, you're not going to Veil of Summer me, are you? That would not be a nice thing to do. Well, I think I'll take Wall of Roots. If I can stop them from getting their mana underneath them, then I'm quite happy with that outcome. So here, if they go for Bowmaster, then I can Bowmaster their Bowmaster. If they don't, I can Seek the Beast. So no triple green for the cord just yet. Because Swamp doesn't cast Lightning Bolt or Renin 6, I'm going to lose a little bit of value here. Seems like the best I can do is probably Mountain, Renin 6, pick up the fetch land. Yep. So I do want to keep the cord from popping off. Bowmaster your insect is reasonable, then assuming they plus and don't have anything else to play, then they'll be able to cord for two. If they have another land, then they can cord for three. But yeah, that seems like the best I can do. Yeah, alternatively, I could have gone Bowmaster your Grist, Bolt Grist, but then they could potentially cord for four, which is pretty scary. Fatal Push, cord in hand. Well, I'm going to cast Questing Druid. Then I'm going to Inquisition and force the action on that cord, unless they have multiples, which is very possible. Okay. Wow. Talk about multiples. Yep. So you can currently cord for two, which would be a Bowmaster or a Wall of Roots, most likely. Ping insect token. And if they want a cord, they have to do it now because this is the third green source with Convoke. Okay, here we go. So now I'm going to lose my Wren. But trading the Wren for the Grist is good. If they don't draw a green source, then they can't Cord. So the next turn they can Cord for Yawgmoth. So definite sense of urgency here. Yeah, and having four lands in hand is not what I was hoping for. So they get sort of one turn of free reign here with Yawgmoth, and then I get to pop off the Saga for a Pithing Needle or whatever the appropriate card is going to be. Okay. So I have a Bowmaster trigger. Which I could target player. Or I could target Young Wolf. If I target the Young Wolf, then they'll probably go sack the Orc army to remove a counter from the Young Wolf. Sack the Young Wolf to remove a counter from the Orc army. Then this will fizzle. It seems like they're going to make that play anyway. I'm just going to target player. Just because the damage and getting a 3-3 does matter here. I don't want all of that to fizzle or otherwise be rendered useless. I have to start playing faster too. I might start narrating a little bit less and just playing fast because I don't want the match to end by me timing out in game three. Okay, so now they have the full combo. They can't kill me this turn, but they can draw a whole bunch of cards. Pithing Needle on Yawgmoth. So let's see what those five cards you just picked up are. Boseiju, Haywire Might. Sure. So now we have the Soul Cauldron versus the Hearse as a staring contest. I mean, I'm going to lose here, but oh, I had auto yield to the undying. Oops. But yeah, I'm dead regardless because I can't beat the board. I can't tap the Hearse because then they get the Soul Cauldron, the Grist. So I think I'm just going to scoop and save some time for game three. If I had more time on the clock, I would, you know, cycle the Lantern and see if I draw some kind of miracle, seek the beast into two relevant things, but I think I just need to get game three going. And how can I win faster? I might need to bring in, might need to do the Goyfs and the Shadow Spear and take out the cards that are not likely to help me win fast enough, which would probably be like the Hearse, the Research Desk, the Soul Guide Lanterns. Just try to play fast and good, fast and good. Sure. So probably take the Wall and the Shouldred and needle the Soul Cauldron. Or that. No Bowmasters, please. We don't want any Bowmasters. Halfling Young Wolf. So now they can actually kill my needle, which is a big problem. I guess I just pass. So they're going to target the halfling. I'm going to bolt the halfling. Just one forest in hand for the opponent. So in theory, if I can stabilize. So we're in my end step right now. You're going to exile my lightning bolt? Sure. End step, I'm seeking the beast. I did find a lightning bolt and a Nile spell bomb, which is very interesting. Fetch the proving ground. I cast the spell bomb, and what are you going to do about it? The Soul Cauldron does kind of neutralize the Renin 6. So I need to just start playing creatures. Oh boy. Wow, this is quite the turn of events. Oh, I don't know what to do at this point. Like, all these creatures have Haywire Might ability, have Yawgmoth ability. The whole game would have been different if I had just needled the Soul Cauldron instead of trying to manage it with the Haywire Might. But, you know, at this point, I'm in a bit of trouble. This probably just ends up worse for me once I Molten Collapse the Grist, so I think I'm going to lose this game to a combination of the Soul Cauldron and the clock. You know, even if I don't actually literally lose by timing out, I don't feel like I was in a position to make the good decisions that would have been needed for winning this game. Soul Cauldron is pretty nasty in the Yawgmoth deck. Don't underestimate it. All right, so I'm going to have to concede this one. Things were looking good for a while when I won that game one, but alas, it was not meant to be. As we get into round number two, I'd like to shout out my partnership with Ultimate Guard. I use Ultimate Guard products myself, from their deck boxes, their Cortex sleeves, Katana sleeves, archives for storage. But Ultimate Guard is you know, a company that makes great products and is a partner that I'm really, really happy to work with. I'm going to be on the draw here. Let's see what my opponent has in store for me. Oof, look at those lands. I mean, I technically have plays that I can make on every turn of the game, so I guess I'll keep it. hand is quite good if I draw a black source on turn one. It's just normal good if I draw a black source on turn two. And then it's weak, but I guess still functional if I don't find a black source right away. Turn one, I get a 1/1. Turn two, I get a 0/1. Then I can start making constructs. Is this another Yawgmoth gamer? So, like, playing the Haywire Might into a possible Bowmasters is pretty mopey, but at least if that happens, the Goyf will come down as a meaningful threat, and then I can Bowmaster their Bowmasters on a future turn. Yep. Oh my god. As if it needed to get worse, they double hit with the Grist. All right. Well, I'm going to attack the Grist because I think it's very likely they'll choose to block. Then I needle the Grist. Smells like a Court of Calling to me. Okay. Well, at least I'm not mana screwed anymore. Wow. I drew another green source and a redundant copy of Boseiju. That is pretty unlikely. All right. I'm going to just tap this for mana. And what can I get? I can get Nihil Spellbomb. I think I'm going to want their research desk here to try to get unmana screwed. So I want that swamp, please. Keep in mind, I can't just mow these things down uncontested because there's the Pendlehaven. So I think what I want to do here is start by just attacking the grist. Yeah, there's I don't think there's anything better that I can do. Yep, fair enough. And let's see what you have in hand. Maybe a redundant copy of Grist. Ooh, Strangle Root Geist. You don't see that one every day. So I'm thinking Bowmaster, target the Dryad Arbor, they'll Pendlehaven it, then I can block with my Orc army. Or not. They wanted to keep up the Pendlehaven. So yeah, I'm fine with this outcome, I think. Just take the one. And I could Bocage you the Pendlehaven. I probably want to start by doing the research desk. Well, Ragavan is very unexciting, but it's better than Verdant Catacombs. Went from from mana screwed to suddenly having too much mana. Okay, what can I possibly send at the Grist? The Orc army can attack, but it can also get blocked for free by the Wall of Roots. I guess technically the Bowmasters can attack too. So I just say okay here. Choosing between killing the halfling or killing the insect token. So basically, I can either kill the halfling and have a 1-1 army. Or I can kill the insect and have a 2-2 army. Just kill the insect. Well, if there's ever going to be a time when I besiege you the Pendlehaven. Maybe I actually do want to just kill the halfling. So let's say I go Boseiju the Pendlehaven. My opponent will pump an insect. Then I can bolt the insect, dash the Ragavan. Still not that exciting. Yeah, I'd rather just save the bolt, I think. Now, how about Boseiju the Pendlehaven? Ragavan at player, everything else at Grist. Hopefully this cleans up the board a little bit, which will mean... okay, that's pretty bad for me, actually. Well, at least the Goyf is uncontested, but they do get to kind of shred the rest of my attackers. Gigantha's getting a lot of action so far. This is only the fourth game I played, and how many times have I cast her? Oh boy. Just gotta keep attacking. Another Yawgmoth. Sure, I guess I'll just Thoughtseize that. So what could happen for me to get back into this game? It would probably have to be, like, Seek the Beast into a removal spell for Yawgmoth. And, I don't know. And something else helpful. Somehow my opponent gets careless with their life total and I double bolt them. It's pretty thin. Any way you look at it. It's funny, remember this is the game where I didn't have black mana until after getting Boseiju'd on like turn 5 or something like that. Also, think about how close this game was for a little while, and then think about if my opponent hadn't gotten the free loyalty and the free extra insect on Grist. So a lot of things could have been different. I'm almost in the realm of just getting one shot by the ultimate. Like here they're going to proliferate my two creatures and the Grist. They attack me for two more. So it's getting I'm going to be put out of my misery pretty quickly, let's put it that way. That's enough. All right. I guess maybe I want both Haywire Mites, having seen how big a problem the Soul Cauldron is. Though I could also take the approach of having engineered explosives, but no. And explosives on two as an answer to Soul Cauldron is pretty awful because it kills so much of my own stuff. So this time, maybe trying a more aggressive approach with the Shadow Spear. Gonna take the Grist. I'll think about how to fight through that Haywire Mite. Well, that answers that. My opponent mulliganed. I'm getting to trade resources a lot here. Can get a 2-for-1 with Kolaghan's Command. Interesting. All right, I'm still just going to go for this. So you discard, I kill your young wolf. If you want to Boseiju my stone in response, then yes, you'll have a 2-2 young wolf, but you'll have only one card remaining in your hand, and I'll have an extra land. Yeah, I think I feel just fine about that outcome. And it spends all their mana for the turn. No land drop for them. I do have Delirium. And I got a 5/5. Like I said, a lot of action for Gigantha in these first two matches. So one Yawgmoth, one other presumably non-land card, whatever they're drawing fresh for this turn, which is a swamp. So what's the best practice here? Probably ping the wolf and block both. I don't know. Decent draw. So now my opponent's life total is actually relevant here. So they get Dryad Arbor. I could Unholy Heat it, but I think I want to save the Unholy Heat for the Yawgmoth. Six life is not a lot of life. That's a really cool and important interaction when you play against Yawgmoth, is when they use Yawgmoth to kill your Bowmasters, you get a Bowmaster trigger even though the creature is going to the graveyard. All right, so moving to game three, do I want to change my configuration on stuff like Goyf, Research Desk, Graveyard Hate? I think I'm going to stick with it. Sure. I mean, that's a good hand against a deck full of small creatures. There are types of hands that they can have where this is going to be really poor, but, you know, if they keep a bunch of ignoble hierarchs, it's going to be great. Blood Crypt, Lightning Bolt. Looks like they mulligan to six cards, so all the better. Oh, wow. No land drop, so they were really reliant on that halfling. Yeah, like Renin 6 and just start using it. So play the stone. Opponent takes no action in response. Now I'll fetch. A mountain. Pick up the mountain or the pick up the Bloodstained Mire. If they eat it with the cauldron, then I Bowmaster the wolf. If they end of turn eat the halfling, I Bowmaster the wolf. If they do nothing, then I'm fine with that. It means the cauldron's not ruining my experience. Okay. Yep. So here I think I want to Bowmaster the young wolf because I guess it doesn't matter because this will still have summoning sickness for the purposes of Court of Calling. All right, my opponent has had enough. I guess just the active Ren and the stone, they felt like they weren't going to be able to fight through it. So 1-1 against Yawgmoth. I'll be back for match number 3. And welcome back to match number 3 of this Modern preliminary event. I am fortunate enough to be on the play, and my hand is, shall we say, flawed, but I am going to keep it. You know, I've turned 2 Thoughtseize or Lightning Bolt. Then I can just start making constructs, or if I find a colored source, then even better for the Renin 6. This is one that I might have to mulligan if I was on the draw, but I think I can certainly justify it on the play. This is my Giganta, by the way. My opponent does not have a companion. Okay. Well, should I just seek the beast then? That's interesting. Or I could just be on the Thoughtseize and make a construct every turn plan. I think Thoughtseize is kind of time sensitive. And if I seek the beast into something, it just means that I'm not gonna be be activating my Urza Saga. Okay. Well, it looks like I should take Violent Outburst. It's definitely going to be hard to start to get any traction with the constructs against so much burn, but if I can stop them from making rhinos for a while, that does improve my chances. Oh, Mutavault to double up on the Flame of Anor. All right. That's fine. I imagine just getting Mountain is going to be A-okay here. Boo! No fair. Subtleties, Force of Negations, no big surprises. And then knowing they have Fire Ice and Flame of Anor in hand, like, man, I was really hoping that they would at least be delayed a little bit in finding the Cascade card. Okay, so now I can Inquisition away Flame of Anor at least. And then what's the move? I could just cast the Questing Druid and try to get it up to a 3-3. Make a construct, then get something, then Inquisition the Flame of Anor. Yeah, that's no good. Seems like it should be Research Desk or Bauble. And of the two, I guess I'll pick the Research Desk. So missing out on Seek the Beast value, but given that my opponent found the turn 3 Shardless Agent, the game has sped up. And it's more about stopping the bleeding and less about getting the long-term value. Subtlety. So Subtlety, Lorien Revealed, and Fire Ice. Everything attacks me. So I could block a rhino, take eight, bolt the rhino. Then I have no answer to the subtlety. I could try to get this up to fighting shape, but then it could just get tapped. Yeah, it seems like I have to block a rhino. Can't take away Fire Ice with Inquisition, so I guess I've got a Bowmasters. And it looks like I'm just dead. Or maybe... Yeah, I think I'm just dead, because... They just flash in the subtlety. I try to block with the Bowmasters. They fire the 2/1/1s. I think I needed at least one more turn of reprieve before the rhinos came out. Oh yeah, they can just fire me as well. Sure. GG. So I've got the engineered explosives, which are definitely good. Bowmasters are pretty weak. Kolaghan's command pretty weak. Could cut the fourth saga, which I sometimes do against Blood Moon decks. I think I like it. Sure, I guess I'll just keep two Bowmasters. So here's another Thoughtseize Proving Ground hand. Given the matchup, I basically know that the critical turn to Thoughtseize is before they hit three mana. So I was going to say I don't have to Thoughtseize on turn one, but now with the Gemstone Caverns, I have to Thoughtseize on exactly turn two. I do have the explosives. All right, well, in any case, I'm going to play the Proving Ground, because if I shocked myself for a Thoughtseize, then I would just have no play on turn two anyway. So I could get a swamp, which insulates me against Blood Moon a little bit. Yeah. So having drawn the Blood Crypt makes it easy. I was going to say swamp doesn't cast Renin 6, but I think it's correct at this point. Probably have to just take a Blood Moon if it's in my opponent's hand anyway, but they could draw it or they could have two. Right, so let's take Violent Outburst. That looks familiar. The fact that it's Shardless Agent too over the Violent Outburst, so I can't even clean everything up with the explosives. Okay. So I could go Explosives Bolt, I could go Explosives Tapped Land, I could go Explosives Saga. Think probably explosives tapped land is where I want to be. Well, I play the Saga and start making constructs, one dies to the flame. But I guess eventually I can get them to a size where they're able to fight. Grab a Shadow Spear. Grab a research desk. Okay, I think I've changed my mind. I'm gonna go for the Saga. But I think I should not bolt the Shardless Agent because I'm gonna need the bolt against Subtlety at some point. Now it's just all up to Urza's Saga to do its Urza's Saga thing. Opponent has two subtleties and three freshly drawn cards. Suspend Footfalls and no land drop. So I do have to sweat a possible Violent Outburst. I think I'll still make a construct. Grab a Shadow Spear, play a tapped land. Burn the Tidebinder. Should have used Lightning Bolt there rather than Unholy Heat. That was a mistake. I didn't appreciate that I have Delirium so easily. Oh my god. Wow, that was a big mistake on my part. I should have just burned it right away. I didn't appreciate that. The Wizard Flame of Anor thing. Well, I'm just getting buried this match. It's like they've kind of just had the best play possible for every turn of both games. I guess I'm not definitely dead. I'm behind, but I can beat just the cards that are showing. Mutavault was the draw for the turn. So pretty much just worrying about the subtleties. Maybe I make a token right away to not get Tidebindered again. One counter remaining on the footfalls. Just going to block. I do want my constructs to be nice and beefy, but on the other hand, I don't want to just die to two hits to the subtlety. It says one counter remaining, so it comes off suspend next turn, so I do need the constructs to be able to fight the rhinos. So maybe I should actually just take it on second thought. Now, to use the research desk, yes, because I can bring it back next turn if needed. If I hit a bolt here, it's lethal. So now I guess I'm dead to a removal spell for the construct. So, oh my god, this is brutal, because, yeah, that does it. Game ended up being relatively close. I'll be back for round four. All right, friends, welcome back to the fourth and final round with Modern Jund Saga. Haven't had a great run so far, but hoping to end with an even 2-2 record. So I'm on the draw with a turn one Ragavan, and then we'll see from there. Oh boy, Yawgmoth number three, huh? This is structurally a really challenging matchup for Jund, because they have so much value, it's hard to kill them through all their ground blockers, and eventually, you know, they get enough time that they just top deck into their combo. Now I've done what I can to try to improve the matchup with, like, you know, that main deck pithing needle and pretty good plan for dismantling all their individual pieces, but the point is, like, if you knew you're going to face Yawgmoth in three quarters of your matches, you probably shouldn't choose Jund. It's not a hopeless matchup, and hopefully, you know, I can prove that over the course of this video, but it's challenging. Anyway, I'm probably not going to win this game if my opponent has a reasonable draw with, you know, turn one unanswered halfling and I don't have any removal spells in my hand. Yep, pretty brutal. So Bowmaster, your Bowmaster has a couple of impacts here. Number one, it just reduces their total board presence for the purposes of Court of Calling or Yawgmoth. Second, it puts some blockers onto the battlefield for when I'm ready to deploy Renin 6. So there's the Yawgmoth himself. So I guess the plan is I'm going to seek the beast, hoping to find some disruption or removal. Failing that, I have to wait 2 turns for the saga to pop off to get a pithing needle or a piece of graveyard hate. Well, that's not a good start. So this means if they have another undying creature, then they get to basically fully combo. And even with just the young wolf, it means every other creature they can play draws them 2 cards. Because you go sack the young wolf, draw a card, then sack the other creature to reset the young wolf, repeat the process. Even that windswept teeth can become a dryad arbor that helps them draw 2 cards. Yeah, I mean, I got nothing. The only thing I could do is use the research desk looking for a 1-mana removal spell, but I don't even have Delirium for Unholy Heat, so what am I going to do? Bolt a young wolf, you know? Just have to let them do their thing and then hope that I can find a way to kill the Yawgmoth. Somehow they stagnate after that. Realistically, we kind of knew I was going to lose this game right from turn one, providing my opponent had a strong draw. I had an Inquisition and a Tarmogoyf. Okay. Well, here's a Nile spell bomb. Right. So they can basically draw as many cards as they please with the understanding that I could have lightning bolts in my hand. Fair enough. Can they do some proliferating stuff? Like, imagine they proliferate, this becomes a 3-3, this becomes a 2-2, they kill off the Goyf. I don't think they can kill me outright, but we're getting dangerously close. Oh, proliferating my Urza Saga? That's a jerk move. Though it might work out actually okay for me. All right, well, you're done Yawgmothing now. Hapatra shouldn't explicitly be a problem, because the Yawgmoth shut off. So here I can either chump or just take 8, which I guess I'll take 8. Because remember, this has 1 damage on it from the Bowmasters. My mana situation is quite inconvenient. Yeah, I mean, I would need to produce four blockers to survive this turn, which I can't do. So almost had like something going with the surprise pithing needle there, but I was just way too far behind. So we've seen this before. I think I've been preferring having more creatures and the Shadow Spear, but I do need pretty much every way. Well, I shouldn't say every way that I can get to kill Agatha's Soul Cauldron, but I think the extra Haywire Might is probably a good idea. Boseiju and Ancient Grudge feel a little too narrow. I played two Ragavans for this league. Quite honestly, if this is any representation of the metagame right now, I could see playing zero because it's, I think Ragavan's quite a liability against Yawgmoth, especially if you lose the die roll. I think I'm fine to search for a basic swamp here and just play a tapped land on turn two. Two Blooming Marsh, Shouldred, Force of Vigor, Halfling, Bowmaster, Young Wolf. Well, I guess I'll take the Bowmaster and then the Shouldred. Well, why don't I take the Bowmaster for now? And then I can decide what to do. Could see a world where it's like take the Halfling and the Bowmaster and then save the Terminate for Shouldred. But I'm going to take a different approach. Would have been sad if I had Inquisitioned away the Halfling and then drawn Lightning Bolt. This is much better. Okay, so how do I feel about Force of Vigor and Terra Sunder? I guess I'll take the Terra Sunder because that can answer Gigantha, and Gigantha might be my plan for winning this game. So take the Terra Sunder, just put that Terminate in my back pocket to deal with only the Shouldred. And then let's get the Gigantha in the mix. Interesting. So Cursed Totem shutting off the Wall of Roots. Remember, they can Force of Vigor, but if they're going to trade two cards out of their hand for the totem, I'm a happy camper. So force pitching, wall of roots, totems down. Hopefully they're just trying to unlock their Shouldred, rather than having found like Grist or Yawgmoth. Bowmaster is the young wolf just to deprive them of a chump blocker while I still can. Really hoping it's Shouldred and not Yawgmoth. Ooh, it's Yawgmoth. Okay, so what happens now? You sack the halfling targeting your young wolf. I'm going to terminate your Yawgmoth. I think I'm going to be okay. Like, they can get a lot of value here, but with the favorable board position and the Bowmasters, they kind of have to sweat. Well, they have to sweat everything. They have to sweat their life total, their number of creatures on the battlefield. Be a great time for a relevant draw step. Jund Saga is neither the best nor the worst thing I could have drawn. Okay. So now let's assume they play the Shouldred. I make a construct, then I can grab, a Shadow Spear with Chapter 3. Come in with the 5-5 Giganta and a 5-5 Trampling Construct. I think that's a game I can still win. If they don't have an untapped land, forget about it. Okay. So the question for them is, what do they want to use the might on? Because they would love to chump block with it and then kill something. But that risks me getting Pithing Needle. Also not sure if they want to let me get all this Urza Saga value. So this makes sense. They're just going to kill the one that has the that's further along in the saga. Seems like I want to just bolt this, the smaller wall. So if they're to block this Bowmaster and block this army, they take 7. It's not a worthwhile attack. So now if they go land Shouldred, they have 3 blockers, and if I get Shadow Spear, it should be lights out. Yep, so I was going to equip it on the Bowmaster, and then any 2 creatures that get through are lethal. So, we advance to game number 9 against Yawgmoth in this four match preliminary event. We've had some good games, some good sets. I'd really love to get this last one. Can't complain about this. I have 2 of my most targeted hate cards. So if they play something boltable, I get Blood Crypt. If not, I get Ziator's Proving Ground tapped. But they have the very bolt-proof opening hand. I think it's got to be Cursed Totem. Now they did bring in a lot of artifact destruction, which I think is correct from their perspective for these post-board games. But if this sticks, it, you know, takes the ability away from the Wall of Roots and stops them from fully comboing. You can't Haywire Might the Cursed Totem, but you can Force of Vigor, Tear Asunder, you can slam a Grisp, but man, no play, not even a land drop. So I don't want to, you know, part of me wants to preemptively needle Grisp, but against somebody who I know has Force of Vigor in their deck, I think that would be unwise. maybe I should have bolted something right away to play around Court of Calling, or not play around it, but just slightly weaken Court of Calling. I'm actually going to bolt the army rather than the Bowmaster, because if I bolt the Bowmaster and they have another one, then they go ping, Ren, and a mass to make this a 2-2, and they would kill my Planeswalker. But this way, I believe they can't kill my Planeswalker. They did have another Bowmaster. Right. Curse Totem does seem really nice. It's a super old card that I like. This is my favorite thing about the Modern Horizons sets. I think there's a lot of valid criticisms about Modern Horizons 1 and 2. But this is, I think, is all upside. Like a cool old card, you know, Curse Totem, Lava Dart, Unearth. I think those are just fun to have available in Modern. So I do have to sweat Court of Calling. I wonder if there's a point where I should Molten Collapse the Wall of Roots. Think probably not, but it's kind of close. Like I can collapse a Grist or a Shouldred at a later time. Let's do this. Okay, it is Court of Calling. So what's going to happen? Wow! The tech, the anti-cursed totem tech. All right. Yep. So totem down. Now I think I'm probably in for collapsing the Wall of Roots. Then I'm going to play Saga and get the Gigantha. they're stuck on mana. What can they have in hand? They can have any number of Shouldreds and Yawgmoths. They can have Grist. They can have another Cord. I feel like they probably don't have Force of Negation or Force of Vigor, but they might. They could have Haywire Might. There's the Grist. So I can either go Collapse This, Needle, Yawgmoth, or I can go Needle, Grist, play Gigantha. If they find a black source and play Yawgmoth, is that a game that I can still win? Interesting. I just hate to blind Needle something when they might not even have it in hand. I think I'm going to go Needle, Grist, play Gigantha. So we'll start with grab a swamp, pull back the Bloodstain Mire. Okay, so I guess I didn't consider maybe just making a construct is better than playing Gigantha. So Collapse This, Needle Yawgmoth, make a construct. If they play another Grist, then I can grab Shadow Spear. Okay, I think I've changed course. So if they play another Grist, make a token, then I make a 2/2 construct, another construct, they're 3/3s, get Shadow Spear, they're 4/4s, attack with a 5/5 trample, they have to put a lot of material in front of it if they want to keep Grist alive. I think that's fine. So I'm feeling pretty safe unless they have like Yawgmoth End Away to kill the Needle, which they could. That's possible when you factor in cards like Haywire Might, Boseiju, Force of Vigor, Court of Calling. I'm not out of the woods. Like, five cards in hand that they've been holding on to for a very long time. This is still scary. And passing with this configuration open would definitely indicate a Cord. Could have made a construct. I'm not totally sure why I didn't. I think I can maybe just let the Wren go. No, the Wren's really good to rebuy or Jund Saga, I think. I boarded out the research desk, so I think I have like Nile Spellbomb or Shadow Spear or Stone of Erich as my primary targets. Maybe just spell bomb. Get the Shadow Spear next time around. Okay. It's a tight game. Like, the board looks good for me. I just want to reiterate this. Board looks good for me, but four cards in hand for the opponent still feels scary. And Ren in six gives me a little bit of an advantage with each turn that passes, but it's not that much of an advantage. Getting rid of that Urza Saga was a strong play. Both players, 5.5 minutes left on the clock. Fatal push my construct. Yeah, you got it. I think I am going to block. Just kill that Grist at all costs. No more Grists, please. Wall of Roots, okay. Oh no. Oh no. All right, come on, Questing Druid into relevant cards. Let's go. I mean, I guess that keeps me in the game. Man, the endurance on the Urza Saga was such a big play. Yuck. Come on, seek the beast. Nope. Man, this was, like I said, nine games against Yawgmoth, and we had some good ones. This last one in particular was really, really good. There were some decisions I could have made differently. A couple big surprises were the endurance on the Urza's Saga. I was kind of counting on that engine for the long-term value. And then also the fatal push on my construct, like them being able to double spell on that key turn and eventually take down my Ren and Six, big problem. All right, I mean the only play that keeps me alive is bolting the Grist so it can't ultimate. But then I go to one and I do I have any outs? So it'd have to be like seek the beast into bolt the Grist and get a life-linking shadow speared creature, but the Bowmasters ends it one turn ahead of schedule. So that's it. I definitely can't say it was a good performance in this preliminary event, but I did enjoy playing the games out for you. I hope you had some fun watching, and I will see you next time here on channelfireball.com. All right, friends, after a quick break on my end, I am back for the fifth and final match of today's Modern League. And my hand looks pretty good, especially if I'm against a creature deck. Okay, is this going to be the third Rakdos matchup of the league? So three Rakdos, one Beanstalk, and one other. That's a pretty good representation of the format. So I do. You always want to think about Blood Moon when you're playing against Rakdos, but it doesn't seem like I'm gonna have the luxury to get a basic forest here. Probably just need to get Proving Ground or Blood Crypt. So they're kind of like baiting me to Fatal Push this because the Bowmasters could answer Ragavan more easily, but I am gonna choose to push it. Okay. Yeah, I'm not expecting any kind of like Liliana type effect, so I think it makes a lot of sense to just play out the Goyf, start hitting hard. Good old Tarmogoyf. So I could go Bolt plus Bowmasters, or I could go Fable. I like bolting this, keep my life total high. I also don't want them to somehow, like, maybe discard Shouldred and cast that off the Voidwalker. I actually think I'm going to save this because if they're passing with all their mana open, like, it's not guaranteed, of course, that they have Bowmasters, but it's one of the things that would make sense. And I don't want to lose the Bowmaster fight and then have them threaten my Fable Chapter 2 with their Bowmasters on the battlefield. Fair enough. So I believe they know the last two cards in my hand. The way they're fetching, they're not necessarily representing Blood Moon in their main deck. Though, of course, they could just have like Fury in their hand and they want to set up double red. Double Bowmasters. Double Bowmasters. So I could actually kill both Bowmasters here, but I don't want to discard the Shouldred anyway. So I'll probably, well, I don't know what I'll do, but I'm not going to use the Fable Chapter 2 at any rate. I think I'm okay with just taking four and then starting to make constructs. Okay, so I can make a construct, which would be basically adding like four power and toughness to the battlefield. I'm gonna be searching for, I think Nihil Spellbomb is best, though definitely a case to be made for Shadow Spear. And then the alternative is I could just go like Bowmasters, Ren, and then replay the Urza Saga, which I don't mind that either. I'm going to go for Nihil Spellbomb because I do think one of the ways that I could lose this game is if my opponent does like a scam grief kind of thing. I'm just going to get the Wooded Foothills because this way I have access to Spellbomb plus draw. I have access to Lightning Bolt. I have access to Double Black next turn off the Shouldred. Sure. So that's the last card in my opponent's hand. That's fine. I mean, they're attacking me rather than Ren. I could double block. I could take it. I feel like there's no real bad outcome here. And this is the late game situation that you're trying to fight towards in this matchup, where it's just like, okay, we've traded off a lot of resources, and now the dust settles, and I have some combination of Urza's Saga and Renin 6, ideally both, to lock up the late game. Okay. So we've seen this matchup before. No big surprises. Just bringing in a couple of graveyard hate cards, and out can come Shadow Spear, Haywire Might. We talked about Boseiju. We talked about Fourth Urza's Saga. I did play a game earlier against Rakdos where I ran out of fetchable targets for Urza's Saga, and that was like a really big deal. I don't know how often the game's going to play out that way. And honestly, the best solution to that problem is probably just adding another Mishra's Bauble to the main deck rather than keeping in a bad card after sideboarding. But here we are, and these are the cards I have to work with. So do I want to leave in a fourth artifact to search for? Like Shadow Spear's not embarrassing. I guess maybe I'll try leaving that and then cut the fourth Saga, which that's at odds too, right? Of like leaving in a bad card to search for with Saga and then trimming a Saga. The reason to trim a Saga is just so you don't draw multiples against Blood Moon, because that's a real beating. It's an easy way to lose. I'm gonna leave the Boseiju because I've Boseiju'd Blood Moons and used that to good effect. Yeah, we'll try it like this. I'm fine with this hand. Just like a lot of reactive stuff, and then hopefully a saga that I can get some value from. Right, I think it's right to just play Blood Crypt untapped. Well, I'm really not scared of any of those cards. I have 100 lightning bolts to take out the Void Walker. I guess explosives, because that can kill two of my construct tokens. But mostly I'm just happy not to see Blood Moon or Fable the Mirror Breaker or whatever it might be. If I had not drawn Tarmogoyf, I would have played Urza's Saga here. But now, since I have a play lined up for next turn, it's all about thinking ahead of like what turns do I want Chapter 2 and Chapter 3 to be available. And usually those are turns where, that's what you want to spend your mana on. And it feels like next turn I want to just play the Goyf, although they do have Terminate. So I'm kind of second thinking that, and maybe I want to just make some constructs before anything else happens. Castle could definitely be good in this game. Another consideration there is I would have been in huge trouble against a Blood Moon if they had drawn it in the interim since I Inquisitioned. But at this point, I know their remaining two cards. It's Takanuma and Terminate. Really interesting attack there. Kind of represents another Bowmasters? I don't know. Because if they were intending to just terminate my construct, then they would attack with both, right? Maybe they're playing around me having Bowmasters, but that doesn't really make much sense either because I could just ping this one. At any rate, I'll block and see what happens. All right, feels like I got away with one there. Just going for full value. I mean, Shadow Spear is going to be pretty good in the long run here, and I don't necessarily want to be drawing extra cards against the Bowmasters, though of course I could bolt that if the need arises. But yeah, Shadow Spear it is. All right, taking three to draw off Castle Lochdwain. It's a good play, but you know there's a limit to how many times my opponent can do that in this game, especially with double bolt sitting in my hand. Yep. Still a known terminate, so it looks like a good opportunity for me to use Bowmasters. Rather than playing the Goyf into the known terminate. So they use Not Dead after all. I'll just cash in the Spell Bomb to trade against the Bowmasters. So they're still holding up that Terminate. Maybe I just want to bolt this turn? Another Terminate. All right. I'm just going to skip casting the Goyfs because they're so easy to trade against. So once they draw their card, they're going to have two Terminates and one Unknown. You're going to cast Grief. I guess that resolves. Took the Season Pyro. How do we feel about Bolt U? I guess Bolt Grief has to be better. And I can equip, or I can play a Goyf, which will trade with Terminate. If my life total was a little bit lower, where I really valued the 2 points of lifelink, I might choose to equip, but at this point, I'm just going to play out my hand and, I guess I'll just have to fight through their removal over the course of a bunch of turns. So one terminate and one unknown non-land card. Another Terminate? Could it be? All Goyfs, dual decks, Goyfs against Terminates? Ooh, Kolaghan's Command, destroy Shadow Spear, return Grief. So now they're going to Grief away my Lightning Bolt, hope to block the Tarmogoyf. It's pretty thin, but they're not dead. Zero cards in hand. Boseiju doesn't do anything besides let me cast Fable, which is plenty good enough. But I can't trigger Revolt. Bowmasters. Sure. So I guess I'm going to push this. Discard this. I drew another Bloodstained Mire anyway. Attack, forced block on the Goyf. They go to one. They can't activate the castle. Play another Fable. And, maybe Fury can keep them alive, but it's even that's pretty close. Oh, oops. I was thinking about Blood Moon there, but I didn't even leave myself with red mana. All right. So I can show the deck list on screen again. That was my final record was 3-2, though it was actually 2-2 and 1, undecided because my opponent had to leave before game three. The good news is I did feel at least slightly favored in those Rakdos matchups. Again, it's just the concept of being a slightly larger mid-range deck. I think I could improve. Like I was noticing some flaws in my post sideboard configurations. A second bauble would mean having, like four quality Saga targets for every post-board configuration if you just keep in two baubles and then whatever card is good for the matchup. I also had a few cards that I wanted to board out against Rakdos, not enough to bring in, so I wouldn't mind having just like second Ley Line of the Void. That's a card you can bring in against Rakdos, and of course it has other applications elsewhere like Living End and we all know Ley Line of the Void is a good sideboard card. I probably don't need to spend too long explaining that. But anyway, it's a fun deck. Nobody's going to tell you it's the best deck in Modern right now. That title probably goes to Rakdos. But it is a deck that has some good things going for it, and Molten Collapse is pretty cool, even though I didn't get to use that as more than just a Dreadbore in this particular league. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video. I enjoyed bringing it to you, and I will see you next time here on ChannelFireball.com.